How is she going to do it?
Are you expecting anyone, Alice?
Yes, I am, and you know I am, and I'll beg your balls to go when he comes.
Well, I'll oblige you, Alice, if Father's gone out first, so you know I can't leave the count until he goes.
Aye!
Good morning, Miss Alice.
Good morning, Mr. Prosser. Father's not gone out yet, he's late.
Oh.
What can we do for you, Mr. Prosser?
Well, I can't say that I came in to buy anything, Miss Hobson.
This is a shop, you know. We're not here to let people go without buying.
Well, I'll just have a pair of bootlaces, please.
What size are you taking boots?
8. I've got small feet, does that matter to the legs?
It matters to the boots. Sit down, Mr. Prosser.
Yes, but I really...
It's time you had a new pair. These Uppers are disgraceful for a professional man to wear.
What?
Number 8 from the third rack, forgive me. Mr. Prosser didn't come in to buy boots, Maggie.
I wonder what does come in here so often.
I'm terrible hard on bootlaces, Miss Hobson.
Do you get 4 pair a day? You must be strong.
I keep a little stock of them as well to be prepared for accidents, you know.
And now you'll have boots to go with the laces, Mr. Prosser. How does that feel?
Very comfortable.
Try standing up.
Yes, that fits all right.
Over the other one.
Oh no, I really don't want to buy
them. You can't go through the streets in odd boots.
What's the price of these?
£1.
£1, I say!
They're good boots, and you don't need to buy a pair of laces today because we'll give them in a discount. Great lace, that is. Of course, if you want leather ones, you're being so strong and breaking some in a pair, you can have them. It's only tuppence more.
These will do.
Very well. You had better have the old pair mended as well. And I'll send them home to you. With the bill.
Well, if anyone had told me I was coming in here to spend £1, I'd call them crazy.
It's not waste. Those boots will last. Good morning, Mr. Prosser.
Good morning.
Maggie, we know you're a pushing salesman.
It'll teach him to keep out of here a bit. He's too much time on his hands.
You know why he comes.
I know it's time we paid a rent for coming. A pair of laces a day is not half enough. Come in here making sheep's eyes at you. I'm sick of the sight of him.
It's all very well for an old maid like to talk. But if Father won't have us go courting, where else can Albert meet me except here when Father's out?
If he wants to marry you, why doesn't he go ahead and do it?
Courting must come first.
It needn't. You see this slipper with a fancy buckle on it to make it look pretty? Courting's like that molass. All glitter, no use to nobody.
Maggie! Just going out for a quarter of an hour.
Yes, Father. Don't be late for dinner. There's Lilla.
It's an hour off dinner time.
So that if you stay more than an hour at the Moonraker's Inn, you'll be late for it.
Moonrakers? Who said
if your dinner's ruined, it'll be your fault.
Well, I'll be eternally...
Don't swear, Father.
No. I'll sit down instead. Now listen to me, you three. I've come to conclusions about you, and I won't have it, you hear me? Interfering with my goings out and comings in. The idea. I'm going to take measures with a lot of you.
I expect Mr. Healy's waiting for you at the Moonraker, Father.
He can go on waiting. At the moment, I'm addressing the rebellious females in this household, and what I say will be listened to and heeded. I've noticed it coming on ever since your mother died. There's been a gradual increase of uppishness towards me.
Father, I'm sure you'd have more time to talk after we close tonight.
I'm talking now, and you're listening. Providence has decreed that you should lack a mother's hand at a time when single girls grow bumptious and must have somebody to rule. But I'll tell you this, you'll none rule me.
I'm sure I'm not bumptious, Father.
Yes, you are. You're pretty, but you're bumptious, and I hate bumptiousness like I hate a lawyer.
If we take trouble to feed you, it's not bumptiousness. You not to be late for your food.
Give and take, Father.
I give and you take, and it's going to end.
How much work do you give us?
That's neither here nor there. At the moment, I'm on uppishness, and I'm warning you. This conduct towards your parents got to change. But that's not all. That's private conduct. And now I pass to broader aspects, and I speak of public conduct. I've looked upon my family as they go about the street, and I've been disgusted. The fair name and fame of Hobson's been outraged by members of Hobson's family, and uppishness has done it.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Maggie, you're pretty, but you can lie like a gas meter. Who had new dresses on last week?
I suppose you mean Vicky and me.
I do.
We should dress as we like, Father, and you can save your breath.
I'm not stopping in for my business appointment in order to save my breath.
You like to see me in nice clothes.
I do. I like to see my daughters nice. That's why I pay Tudsbury the draper £10 a year ahead to dress you proper. Pleases the eye and it's good for trade. But I'll tell you this. If some women could see themselves the way men do, they'd have a shock. And I'll have words with Tudsbury and all for letting you dress up like guys. I saw you and Alice through Moonraker's parlor on Thursday night, and my friend Sam Mintz.
A publican.
Why, a publican? As honest a man as God Almighty ever placed behind a bar, my ladies. My friend Sam Mintz asked me who you were. And well, he might. You were going down Chapel Street with a hump added to nature behind.
Father.
The hump was wagging. And you put your feet on pavement as if you had chilblains. Aye, stiff neck above, weak knee below. It's immodest.
It is not immodest, Father. It's the fashion to wear bustles.
Then the hell of a fashion.
Father, you are not in the Moonrakers now.
You should open your eyes for other ladies' wear.
If what I saw on you was any sort, I should do not of kind. I'm a decent-minded man. I'm Hobson, I'm British middle class, and I stand for common sense and sincerity. You're affected, which is bad sense and insincerity. You've overstepped nice dressing, and you've tried grand dressing, which is the occupation of fools, and such as have no brains. You forget the dignity of trade and the unparalleled virtues of the British Constitution, which are all based on the sanity of the middle classes combined with the diligence of the working classes. You're losing balance, and you're letting things which don't matter overseeing the things that do. And if you wish to be a factor in the world in Lancashire, or a factor in the House of Hobson, you'll become sane.
Do you want to stress like mill girls?
No! Nor like French madams, neither. It's un-English, I say.
We shall continue to dress fashionably, Father.
Then I have a choice for you two. You, Vicky, I'm talking to, and Alice. You'll become sane if you're going on living here. You'll curb this uppishness that's growing on you. Or you can just get out of this and exercise your gifts on someone else than me. You don't know when you're well off, but you'll learn it when I'm through with you. I'll choose a pair of husbands for you, my girls. That's what I'll do.
Can't we choose husbands for ourselves?
I've been telling you for the past 5 minutes you're not fit to choose dresses for yourselves.
You're talking a lot to Vicky and Alice, Father. Why do I come in?
You?
If you're doing husbands round when I come in.
That's a good one. You with a husband.
Why not?
Why not? I thought you'd sense enough to know, but if you want the brutal truth, you're past the marrying age. You're a proper old maid, Maggie, if ever there was one.
I'm 30.
Aye, 30 and shelved. All the women can't have husbands, but you others now. I'll have less uppishness from you, or else I'll just shove you off my hands onto some other men. You can just choose which way you like.
1 o'clock dinner, Father.
Look here. I'm the one who sets the hours in this house. It's 1 o'clock dinner because I say it is, not because you do.
Yes, Father.
As long as that's clear, I'll go. Oh, no, I won't! Mrs. Hepworth's getting out of the carriage. Good morning, Mrs. Hepworth. What a lovely day.
Good morning, Hobson. I've come about those boots you sent me home.
Ah, oh, yes. Oh, they look very nice.
Get up, Hobson. Look ridiculous on the floor. Now, who made these boots?
We did. Our own make.
Can you answer a plain question?
Who made
these boots?
They were made on premises.
Ah, young woman. You seem to have some sense when you serve me. Can you answer me?
I believe so, but I'll make sure for you, Mrs. Tupper.
Toby!
You wish to see the identical workman, madam.
I said so.
Yeah, I am responsible for all work turned out here.
Never said you weren't.
Yes, Miss Maggie.
Ooh. Ma'am. Did you make these boots?
No, ma'am.
Then who did? Am I to question every soul in the place before I find out?
There's Willie's making those.
Tell Willie I want him.
Certainly, ma'am. Willie!
Who's Willie?
Name of Mosset, madam, but I assure you if there's anything wrong,
I am capable of making the man suffer for it.
Are you, Bossum?
Yes, ma'am.
Did you make these boots?
Yes, I made them last week.
Take that. We'll see what's on it.
Writing?
Read it.
Try.
Bless the man, can't you read?
I do a bit. Only it's such funny print.
It's the usual italics of a visiting card, my man. Now, listen to me. I heard about this shop, and what I heard brought me here for these boots. I'm particular about what I put on my feet.
I assure you, madam, it will not occur again.
What on?
I don't know.
Then hold your tongue. Amos, I've been to every shop in Manchester, and these are the best made pair of boots I've ever had. Now, you will make my boots in future. You hear that, Hobson?
Of course you shall.
Mossop, you will keep that card, and you will not dare leave here to go to another shop without letting me know where you are.
Oh, well, we won't make a change.
How do you know? The man's a treasure. And I expect you underpay him.
Don't do, Willie. You can go.
Yes, sir.
He's like a rabbit.
Can I take your order for another pair of boots, Mrs. Hepworth?
Not yet, young woman. But I shall send my daughters here, and mind you, that man's to make the boots.
Certainly, Mrs. Hepworth.
Good morning.
Good morning, Mrs. Hepworth. Very glad to have the honor of serving you, madam. I wish some people would mind their own business. What does she mean praising a workman to his face for?
I suppose he deserved it.
Deserved? Be blowed. Making them uppish, that's what it is. Last time she sets foot in my shop, I give you my word.
Don't be silly, Father.
Think she owns the world because she lives in Hope Hall?
Well, that's a bit of a start, man.
Eh? Oh, good morning, Jim.
You're doing a good class training as a character going to your horse.
What?
What's that, Mrs. Hepworth?
Mrs. Hepworth's an old and valued customer of mine.
That's funny. You deal with Hope Hall and you never mentioned it.
Oh, I've made boots for her and her circle for how long, Maggie? Well, I don't know.
You kept it dark. Well, yeah. Won't you come around yonder?
That is no.
Oh, you will?
No. Get away, you girls. I'll look after shop. I want to talk to Mr. Heather.
Well, can't you talk in the moonlight?
Yes, but Denton and Tubby and Tutsbury there.
Oh, it's private then. What's the trouble, Henry?
They're the trouble. Your daughters worry you, Jim?
Nah, they mostly do as I bid them. And the missus do as I let them, if they don't.
A wife's a handy thing, and you don't know it proper till she's taken from you. I felt grateful for the quiet when my Mary fell on rest, but I see my mistake now. I used to think I was hard put to it when she wanted someone out of me, but the dominion of one woman is paradise compared to the dominion of three.
Sounds a sarcasm, Henry.
I am a talkative man by nature, Jim. You know that.
You're an orator, Henry. I doubt John Bright himself is better gifted to the game than you.
Nay, that's putting it too strong. A good case needs no flattery.
Well, you're the best debater of Moonraker's parlor.
Well, that's no more than truth. Yes, Jim, in the estimation of my fellow men, I give forth words of weight. In the eyes of my daughters, I'm a windbag.
Nay, never.
I am. They spurn my wisdom, Jim. They answer back. I've landed in a hole, a straight, undignified hole. My own daughters have the upper hand of me.
Women are worse than men begin to fool themselves.
Women's foolishness begins where man's leaves off.
They want a firm hand, Henry.
I've lifted up my voice and roared at them.
Oh, beware of roaring at women, Henry. Roaring is merely a hollow sound. It's like trying to defeat an army with banging drums instead of cold steel. And the steel in a man's character, that subdues the women.
I've tried all ways and I'm fair with her. I don't know what to do.
Quit roaring at him and get wet.
Thought of that. Problem is, find the men.
Oh, the men's coming enough. Oh, are you looking for angels and bridges?
I want my daughters to marry temperance young men, Jim.
You keep your ambitions within reasonable limits, Henry. You've three daughters to find husbands for.
Two, Jim. Two.
Two?
Vicky and Alice are supposed to be window dressing in the shops, but Maggie... Maggie's too useful to let go, and she's a bit ripe for marrying, is our Maggie?
Oh, I see, do double her age. Still, leaving her out, you got two.
What'll do for a start, Jim? It's a thing I've noticed about wenches. They get one wedding in the family and goes through the lot just like measles.
Well, you win them on and you win them temperate. It's gonna cost you a bit, yeah.
Oh, well, get my hand down for the wedding, all right?
A woman like you need to do more than that. There's things called settlements.
Settlements?
You've to bait your hook to catch fish, Henry.
Then I'll know to go fishing.
Oh, but you said you...
No, I've changed my mind. I had a fancy for a bit of peace, but there are some luxuries a man can buy too, dear. Settlements, indeed.
I had a mind of mine.
You keep them there, Jim. I'll rub along and chance it. Settlements, indeed.
You save their keep.
They work for that, and they're none of them big eaters.
And the wages?
Wages? You think I pay wages to my own daughters? I'm not a fool.
Well, then it's all off.
From the moment you breathe the word settlements, it were dead off, Jim. Let's go round to Moonrakers and forget there's such a thing as women in the world. Chop, chop! Just going out, Maggie.
Dinner's at one, remember?
Dinner will be when I come in for it. I am master here.
Yes, Father. 1 o'clock.
Come on, Jim.
Dinner at 1:30, girls. We'll give him 30 minutes.
Trade here.
HOBSON'S never taught you to make boots the way you do.
I had no other teacher.
I needed none. You're a natural born genius in making boots. It's a pity you're a natural fool at all else.
I'm not much good at upper leather, and that's a fact.
When are you going to leave HOBSON'S?
Leave HOBSON'S? I thought I'd go satisfaction.
Don't you want to leave?
Well, me? I've been in HOBSON'S all my life, and I'm not for leaving till I'm made.
I said you were a fool.
I'm a loyal fool.
Don't you want to get on, Will Mossop? You heard what Mrs. Hepworth said. You know the wages you get, and you know the wages that make like you could get. One of the big shops in Manchester.
Nay, I'll be afraid of going them fine places.
What keeps you here? Is it the people?
I don't know what it is. I'm used to being here.
Do you know what keeps this business on its legs? Two things. One's the good boots that you make that sell themselves. The other's the bad boots that other people make. And I said, we're a pair, Will Mossop.
You're a wonder in the shop, Miss Maggie.
And you're a marvel in the workshop. Well?
Well, what?
It seems to me to point one way.
What way is that?
You're leaving me to do the work, my lad.
I'll be getting back to my school.
You'll go when I've done with you. I've watched you for a long time now, and everything I've seen I've liked. I think you'll do for me.
In what way, Miss Maggie?
Will Mossop be my man? 6 months I've counted on you, and it's got to come out sometime.
But I never said...
I know you'd never. Not have been left to me to do the job like this.
I'll sit down. I'm feeling queer, like, what does want me for?
To invest in. You're a business idea in the shape of a man.
I've got no head for business at all.
But I have. My bread and your hands make a working partnership.
Partnership? Oh!
That's a different thing. I thought you were asking me to wed you.
I am?
Well, by gum. Are you a master's daughter?
Maybe that's why you're lost. Maybe I've had enough of father and you're as different from him as any man I know.
But it's a bit awkward, like...
And you don't help me any, lad. What's awkward about it?
You talking to me like this?
I'll tell you something, Will. It's a poor sort of woman who'll stay lazy when she sees the best chance coming from her. A Salford's life? It's too near the bone to lose things for fear of speaking out.
I'm your best chance.
You are that, Will.
Well, by gum, I never thought of this.
Think of it now.
I am doing. Only the blow's a bit too sudden to think very clear. I have a great respect for you, Miss Maggie. You're a shapely body, and you're a masterpiece at selling a shop, but when it comes to marrying, I'm bound to tell you that I'm not in love with you.
Wait till you're asked. I want your hand in mine, your word for that. You go through life with me first, best as we can get out of it.
We'd not give much without there's love between us, lass.
I've got the love, all right.
Well, I've not. And that's honest.
We'll get along without.
You're a desperate sinner, miss. It's a puzzle to me, always. What does your father say?
He'll say a lot and he can say it. It'll make no difference to me.
Well, try to not upset him. It's not worthwhile.
I'm judge of that. You're going to wed me, Will.
Oh. Nay, I'm not really. I can't do that, Maggie. I can see that I'm disturbing your arrangements, like. But I'll be obliged if you put this notion from
me. When I make arrangements with my lad, they're not made for upsetting.
What makes this so desperate awkward is that I'm talking.
You're what?
I'm talking. To Ada Figgins.
Then you'll get loose and quick. Who's Ada Figgins? Do I know her?
I'm a lodger at her mother's.
The scheming hussy. It's not that sandy girl who brings her dinner.
She's golden haired as Ada Aye. She'll be here soon.
And so shall I. I'll have a talk with Ada. I've seen her and I know the breed. Ada's a helpless sort.
She needs protecting.
That's how she got you, was it? Yes. I can see her clinging round your neck until you fancied you were strong. But I'll tell you this, my lad, it's a desperate poor kind of woman who'll look for protection to the likes of you.
Ada does!
And that gives me ways of her. She's born to meekness, Ada is. You wed her and you'll be an 18 shilling a week bootmaker for the rest of your life. You'll be a slave. And a contented slave.
I'm not ambitious that I know of.
No. But you're going to be, I'll see to that. You've got my work cut out for me.
I wish you'd leave me alone!
About you. So does the flyer when the spider catches him. You're my man, Willie Wassup.
Aye. So you say Ada would tell another story, though.
Hey! Hey! Oh, well, there's you to know.
Thank you, Ada.
I want a word with you. You're treading on my foot, young woman.
No, I mean Miss Hobson.
What's this with you and him?
Oh, Miss Hobson. It's good of you to take notice, that right?
Ada, she wants...
Oh, Josh, this is for me and her to settle. Take a fair look at him, Ada.
Will.
Not much for two women to fall out over, is there?
Oh, maybe he's not so much to look at. You should hear him play.
Play? Are you a musician, Will?
Play the jew's harp.
Oh, that's what you've seen him, is it? A gawky fellow that plays a jew's harp.
Oh, I see the lad I love, Miss Hobson.
It's a funny thing, but I can say the same.
You?
That's what I've been trying to tell you, Ada. And by gum, she's going to have me from you if you don't be careful.
So we're quit so far, Ada.
You'll pardon me. You spoke too late, Willamy's temper.
That's the past. It's a future I'm looking to. What's your idea for that?
You mind your own business, Miss Hobson. The gossip's no concern at all.
That's what I try and tell myself. Only she'll have it. It's no use.
Not an atom. I've asked for your idea of Willie's future. If it's a likelier one than mine, I'll give you best. And you can have the lad.
Well, I'm trusting him to make the future right.
It's as bad as I thought it was. Willie, you wed me.
But it's de la robbery!
Aren't you going to put up a better
life for me than that, Ada. You're fair giving me to her.
No, Possum. You take your orders from me in the shop, and I've told you. You'll wed me.
Seems like there's no escape.
You wait while I get you to help me, lad. I'll set me mother onto you.
Oh, so the mother's made this match.
She has a bother bit to do with it.
I've got no mother will.
She need not neither.
So, can I sell you a pair of clogs, Miss Figgins?
No, nor anything else.
Then you've no business here, have you?
Will, are you going to see me ordered out?
This ain't a shop, Ada.
You want to go? Lock this?
She means it.
It's cruel to
heart! Stop it! Stop it! And I'm whimpering about it!
Not whimpering! And I'm not crying neither! But he'll whimper tonight when my mother sets about him!
No!
Well, Mossip, I'm telling you, you'll come home tonight to a thick ear!
I'd really rather with Ada, Maggie, if it's all the same to you.
Why? Because of her mother?
She's a terrible what side to her tongue, has Mrs. Figgins.
Are you afraid of her?
Yes.
You needn't be.
Yes, but you don't know her. She'll draw me till I'm black in the face when I go home tonight.
You won't go home tonight?
Not go.
No. You've done reporting there. You'll go around to Tommy Woodlaw's when you knock off work, and Tommy will go around for your things at Mrs. Figgins.
And I'm not to go back there. Never. No more.
No.
It's like an happy dream. Maggie, you do manage things.
And while Tommy's there, you can go around and see about putting the bands up for us too.
Bands?
Yes.
Oh. Oh. But I'm hardly used to the idea yet.
You have 3 weeks to get used to it in. Now, you can kiss the whip.
That's forcibly spitting all. It's like saying I agree to everything
yes.
He kisses. And I don't agree yet.
Come along, do I tell you, Will?
Now? Within here?
Yes.
Oh, I couldn't.
What's the matter with Willie? He's a bit upset because I told him he's to marry me. Isn't it looking nicely? You're about to marry
Willie Master? Willie Master?
You've kept it quiet, Maggie. You know about it pretty near as soon as Willie does himself.
Well! I don't know!
I know! And if you're afraid to speak your thoughts, I'm not. Look here, Maggie, what you do touches us and you're mistaken if you think Arlene Willie Mossop for my brother-in-law. Is there supposed to be some disgrace in him?
Yes, father, if there's disgrace! And look at me! I'm hopes to marry Albert Prosser till this happened!
You'll marry Albert Prosser when he's able. And that'll be when he starts spending less on laundry bills and hair cream.
Well, what about that dinner?
It'll be ready in 10 minutes.
You said 1 o'clock.
Yes, Father, 1:30. If you just wash your hands, it'll be ready when you are.
I won't wash my hands. Don't hold with such finicky ways, and well, you know it.
Father, have you heard the news about our Maggie?
News? There is no news. Same old story. Puppishness. So, you keep a starving man from the meat he earns by the sweat of his brow. But you win your price.
Don't lose your temper, Father. You'll maybe need it soon in Vicky's states.
What's Vicky been up to?
Nothing. It's about Will Mossop, Father.
Will?
Yes. What's your opinion of Will?
Decent enough, lad. I'm not against him at all.
Would you like him in the family?
Whose family?
Yours.
I'm going to marry Willie, Father. That's what all the fuss is about.
Marry? You? Mossop?
You thought me past the marinade. I'm not, that's all.
Didn't you hear me say I do the choosing of husbands around here?
You said I was too old to get a husband.
You are. You all are. And if you're not, it makes no matter. It makes no matter. There'll be no husbands here.
But you said...
I've changed my mind. I've learned something since then. There's far too much expected of a father nowadays. There'll be no weddings here.
Oh, Father!
Go and get my dinner set and talk less. Go on now. I'm not in right temper to be cross.
You and I'll be straight with one another, Father. I'm not a fool, and you're not a fool. And things might as well be put in their places as left untidy.
I tell you, my mind's made up. You can't have Willie Mossip. Lass, his father's a workhouse brat, a Kumba chance.
It's news to me there were snobs in Salford. I have all the nuts about to settle my life's course, and a good course too, so think on.
I'd be the laughing stock if I allowed it. I want to have it, Maggie. It's hardly decent at your time of life.
I'm 30, and I'm marrying Willie Mossop. And now, I'll tell you my terms.
You're in a nice position to state terms, my lads.
You'll pay my man, Will Mossop, the same wages as before. And as for me, I've given you the better part of 20 years of work without wages. I'll work 8 hours a day in future, and you shall pay me 15 shillings by the week.
You think I'm made of brass?
You'll soon be made of less than you are now if you let Willie go. And if Willie goes, I go, that's what you've got to face.
I might face it, Maggie. Shop hands are cheap.
Cheap ones are cheap. The sort that you'd have to watch all day, and you'd feel happy helping them to tie up parcels and sell laces with Tudbury and Healer and Mince up in their ale without you. I'm value to you, so's my man. And you can both sit at the Moonrakers, that your daughter Maggie's made the straightest, finest match as woman's made this 50 year. And you can put your hand in your pocket and do what I propose.
I'll show you what I propose, Maggie. Will Mossop! I cannot leather you, lass. You're female and contempt. But I can leather him. Come on, Will Mossop! You've taken up with my Maggie, I hear.
Nay, I've not. She's done the taking up.
Well, Willie, either way, you've fallen on misfortune. Love has led you astray, and I feel bound to set you right.
Maggie, what's this?
I'm watching you, my lad.
Mine, Willie. I bear you no malice. You can keep your old job. But we must beat the love out of your body. And every day you come to work with love still sitting in you, you'll get a leathering.
You might be loving me. You're making a great mistake, Mr. Hobson.
You'll put aside this weakness you have for my Maggie, leave a liking for a sound skin. Now, you'll waste a great deal of brass at chemist if I met you for a week with this.
I'm not wanting that Maggie. It's her that's after me, but I'll tell you this, Mr. Hobson. If you touch me with that belt, I'll take her up quick, aye. And stick to her like glue.
There's no one answer to that, my lad.
I've no one answer back. Maggie, I've not kissed you yet. I shirked before, but by gum, I'll kiss you now. And take you and hold you. And if Mr. Upson raises up that strap again, I'll do more. I'll walk straight out of shop with thee and us two settle for ourselves.
Willie? I knew you had it in you, lad.
Room.
Then do something, we're not stopping you.
You're not telling me neither. You're not supposed to take me orders from the shop.
I don't know what to tell you to do. Nobody seems to want any boots made.
The art class trade has dropped like a stone this last month. Of course, we can go on making clogs for stock if you like.
Then you'd better.
You know, stock by selling clogs won't pay the wages, let alone the rent. But clogs are your orders, Miss Alice.
You suggested it.
I made the remark. But I'm not a rash man, and I'm not going to be responsible to the master with his temper so naughty and all since Miss Maggie went.
Oh dear, what would Miss Maggie have told you to do?
I'm sure I couldn't tell you that, miss, but I don't recollect things being as slack as this in her time.
You don't help us much for an intelligent foreman.
When you've told me what to do, I'll use my intelligence and see it's done properly.
Then go and make clogs.
Them's your orders?
Yes.
Thank you, Miss Alice.
I wonder if I've done right.
That's your lookout.
I don't care. It's Father's place to be here to tell them what to do.
Maggie used to manage without him.
Oh yes, go on. Blame me that the place is all sixes and sevens.
I don't blame you. I know as well as you do that it's Father's fault. You ought to spend more time looking after his business instead of spending more time than ever at the Moonrakers. But you need to be snappy with me about it.
I'm not snappy myself at these figures. I can't get them right. What's 17 and 25?
52, of course.
Well, it doesn't balance, right? Oh, I wish I was married and out of it.
Same here.
You?
You need to think you're the only one.
Well, you're sly, Vicky Hobson. You've kept it to yourself.
Well, it's just as well now that I did. Maggie spoils our chances forever. Nobody's trying to get Willie mobbed at for a brother-in-law.
Maggie, you here?
I thought we just got in.
Vicky, what's this Mr. Beanstalk telling me about you and him?
If he's told you, I suppose you know.
Well, she got it out to me, Vicky.
I don't know that it's any business of yours, Maggie.
You'll never get no father with it by yourself, from what I hear father's carrying on.
That's your fault, yours and his.
Leave that alone. I'm here to help you if you have my help.
Oh, that's very kind of you, Miss Maggie, I must say. Your father has turned very awkward.
I reckon he'll change. How's your young man been in here this morning, Alice?
My young man, he's not
Albert Prosser.
No.
Do you expect him?
He's not been here so often since you and Willie must.
Since when?
Since you made him buy that pair of boots he didn't want.
I say? He didn't like paying for taking pleasure in our shop. Well, if he's not expected, somebody must go for him. Prosser, Pilkington and Prosser. So this is at Betsy Square.
That's right,
isn't it?
Yes, Albert's and Prosser.
Ah, quite a big man in his way.
Then will you go and fetch him, Mr. Beanstalk? Tell him to bring the paper with him.
You're ordering folk about a bit.
I'm used to it.
It's all right, Vicky.
Is it? Suppose Father comes in and finds out when I and Freddy here.
He won't.
He's beyond his time already.
I know. You must have worried Father very badly since I went to Alice.
Why?
Tell them, Mr. Beanstalk.
The fact is, Mr. Hobson won't come because he's at our place just now.
At your Conrad house, what's Father doing there?
He's sleeping, Vicky.
Sleeping?
Well, you see, we've set a trap in our place that opens up into the pavement. And your father, well, he wasn't looking very carefully where he was going. And he fell into it.
Fell? His father hurt?
Well, he's snoring very loudly. But no, he's not hurt, no. He fell soft under some bags.
Now you can go for Albert Prosser.
Is that all? Would you be told?
It's all there is to tell until Freddie's seen the solicitor.
I'll not be long.
John, I have a job here for you when you get back.
I didn't want you aiming at Maggie.
The difference between us is that I do. I always did.
It's a queer thing you aimed at.
I've done uncommon well myself. And I've come here to put things straight for you. Father told you to get married in your dark shape.
He changed his mind.
I don't allow for folks to change their minds. He said get married and you're going to.
Yeah, but made it easier for us, you know.
Meaning Willie.
It wasn't my fault, Miss Vicky, really, it wasn't.
You call her Vicky, Will.
No, he doesn't.
He's in the family or going to be. And I'll tell you this. If you want your Freddie and if you want your Albert, you'll be respectful to my Willie.
Willie Moss was our boot hand.
He was. And you'll let bygones be bygones. He's as good as you are now. And better.
Hey, come, Maggie.
Better, I say. They're shop assistants. You're your own master, aren't you?
Got my name rolled up on the windows, but I don't know so much about being master.
That's his business card. William Mossop, practical boot and shoemaker, 39A Oldfield Road, Salford. William Mossop, master bootmaker. That's the man that you're privileged to call in his Christian name. Aye. And I'll do more for you than allow you to call him in his name. Yon both of you can kiss him for your brother-in-law to be.
Hey, Maggie, I'm no great hand at kissing.
I've noticed that. A bit of practice will do you no harm. Come along, Vicky.
But Maggie, a shop of your own.
I'm waiting, Vicky.
I don't see a chore to drive it to it.
You hold your hush.
But how did you manage it? Where did the capital come
it
from?
It came. Will, stand still. She's making up her mind to it.
I trust this leaf not putting it into trouble.
You'll take your proper place in this family, my lad. Trouble or no trouble?
I don't see why you should always get your way.
It's just a habit. Come along now, Vicky. I've got a lot to do today and you're holding everything back.
It's under protest.
Protest? What kiss? Your turn now, Alice.
do it. If you'll help me with these books, Maggie.
Books? Father's put you in my place.
Yes.
Then you must take the consequences. Your books aren't my affair.
I think you might help me, Maggie.
I'm surprised that you really are, Alice, I am. After what you've just been told, exposing your books to a rival shop, you ought to know better. Will's waiting, and you're to kiss him hearty now.
Very well.
There's more to kiss a nice young woman than I thought.
Don't get too fond of it, my lad.
Well, I hope you're satisfied, Maggie. You've got your egg in. And now perhaps you'll tell us if there's anything you want in this shop.
Eh? Are you trying to sell me something?
I'm asking you, what's your business here?
I told you once. Will it be taking the day off to put you in the way of getting wed?
Looks like things are slow at your shop if you can walk around in your best clothes on a working day.
It's not a working day with us. It's a wedding day.
You've been married this morning?
Not us. Well, my sister's there when I wed. It's at 1 o'clock at St. Philip's.
But we can't leave the shop to come.
Why not? It's trade, so brisk.
No, but
not much high class trade doing with you, eh?
I don't see how you knew.
I'm gonna kiss him. You'll not miss out by coming with us to the church, and we'll expect you tonight for a wedding spread.
He's asking us to approve.
You have approved. You've kissed the bridegroom. And now you go to the church with us. Father's safe where he is.
And the shop?
Tommy can see to the shop.
And that reminds me.
You can tell me something. There's some rings in that drawer there, Vicky.
Brass rings?
Yes, I want one. There, that's the size.
Damn, you're not taking
it! Yes, I am. Well, me aren't throwing money around, but we can pay our way. There's 4 pence for the ring. Gather it up, Vicky.
Wedding with a brass ring?
This one will do. It's a nice fit. Alice, you haven't entered that sale into your book. No wonder you're worried with accounts if that's the way you see to them.
I'm a bit too much astonished, don't you, to think about accounts. I bring out the stock.
They're always out of someone's stock.
I think shame to myself to be married with a ring like that.
And people can't afford the best they've got to do without.
I'll take good care. I never go without.
Somewhere detached for you, I suppose. And a house full of new furniture.
Haven't you furnished?
Partly what? We've made a start of the Flatiron Market.
I'd stay single, soon have other people's cast-off sticks in my house. Where's your pride once?
I'm not getting wed myself to help the furnishing trade along. I suppose you turn your nose up too at second-hand stuff, Vicky.
I'd start properly or not at all.
Then neither of you will have any objections to my clearing out the lumber room. We've brought a handcart round with us.
You made sure of things?
Yes. Go on upstairs, Will, I told you what to bring.
Wait a bit.
Go on.
Let me tell you, if you claim the furniture from your old bedroom, that's my room now, and you'll not budge a stick of it.
I expected you to promote yourself, Ellen, but I said lumber room. There's 2-3 broken chairs, and a sofa with the springs all gone. You'll not tell me they're of any use to you.
Nor to you, neither.
Will's handy with his fingers. I'll put to bed in them this afternoon, and they'll be secure against you come to sit on supper time tonight.
And that's the way you're going to live, with cast-off furniture.
Ah, in 2 cellars in Oldfield Road.
A cellar?
2 of them, Alice. One of them working and the other one to sleep in.
Well, it'd not suit me.
Nor me.
Well, it suits me just fine. And with Will and me are richer than a lot of you put together. It'll be a grand satisfaction and look back to see what we began.
Just a minute, Will. These chairs are not so bad.
You can sit on one tonight and see.
You know, minted up these chairs would do very well for my kitchen when I'm wed.
Yes, or for mine. I reckon my parlour comes from your kitchens, though.
Parlour? I thought you said you'd only one living room.
Then it might as well be called a parlour by any other name. Put the chairs on the handcart, Will. And as for your kitchens, you've none yet. And if you want my plan for you to work, you just remember that all I'm taking off of you is some crippled old stuff that isn't yours. And what I'm getting for you is marriage portions.
What? Marriage portions? Maggie!
Don't get your hats on or you'll be late for church.
But aren't we so fast?
You're not all right, be cooking the things. Good morning, Albert. Mm. Have we got what Freddie asked you for?
Yes, but I'm afraid I'm
late. Never mind being afraid. Freddie, I told you I have a job here for you. Go upstairs with Will, there's stuff to come down. Put your coat off to it. Now then, Albert.
Yes, but Miss Maggie, you know this.
I've told you what to do. And you can't do it with your coat on. That stuff isn't here in 2 minutes. I'll leave a lot of you to tackle this by yourselves and a nice hash you'll make.
All right, Maggie.
legal English, Miss Hobson.
I thought it went the sword that we talked in Lancashire. What is it when you've got behind the whereases and the saids and to-its?
It's what you told Freddy to instruct me. Action against Henry Horatio Hobson for trespass on the premises of Jonathan Beanstalk and Company, corn merchants of Chapel Street, Salford, with damages done to certain corn bags caused by falling on them, and further damages claimed for spying on the trade secrets of the aforesaid J.B. and Co.
Well, I'll take your word for it, then it means I shouldn't have thought it. But I suppose lawyers are like doctors. They've each a secret language of their own, so if you get a letter from one lawyer, you've got to take it to another just to get it read. Just like a doctor sends you to a chemist with a rigmarole that no one else can read, so they can charge you what they like for a drop of coloured water.
Mate, is that your instruction, Miss Hobson? Apart from saying there's good law, and they're not beginning of going into court with
Nobody
it.
Nobody asked you to. They won't go into court.
Hello?
Open that door for them, Albert.
Quarter to one.
Girls, if you're late for my wedding, I'll never forgive you. We're coming. Put your coat on. Now then, Freddy, you take this paper, put it on my father and yourself.
What, now?
Now? Yes, of course, now. He might wake at any time.
Well, he's seen fast enough. Aren't that to come to the church?
Yes, if you do it fast enough to get there before we're through.
All right.
Hand card. Are we to take it with us?
To church? You can't do that.
I'll take it, Mum.
And how are you going to figure the church? That's not for me, my lad.
You can't very well leave it where it is.
No. There's only one thing for it. You'll have to take to our place, Albert.
Me?
There's a key. 39A Oldfield Road.
Yes, but to push a hand card from Salford in broad daylight.
It won't dirty your collar.
Suppose some of my friends see me.
Look here, my lad. If you're too proud to do a job like this, you're not a husband for my sister.
It's the look of the thing. Can't you send somebody for me?
No. You can think it over. Tommy!
Yes, miss. Watch Miss Maggie.
Come up, Tommy. You're in charge of the shop. We'll be out for a while.
I'll be up in half a minute, Miss Maggie.
Well, Albert Prosser?
I suppose I must.
That's right. We'll call it your wedding gift to me. And I'll allow that you're putting yourself out of it for me. Well, Will, you've not had much to say for yourself today. How's it feeling, lad?
I'll go through with it, Maggie.
Hey.
My mind's made up. I've got right up to point. I'm ready.
It's church we're going to, not the dentist.
I know. You get rid of something at the dentist, but it's taking something on to go to church with the wench, and the Lord knows what.
See, the Will, I have respect for church. Yon's not the place for lies. The parson's going to ask you, will you wed me? And you either have to answer truthfully or not at all. If you're not willing to, just say it now.
I'll tell
him. And truthfully.
Yes, Maggie. I'm resigned. Growing on me, lass. I'll toil the line with you.
We're ready, Maggie. In time you were. It's not your wedding to dress in for. Come up, Tommy, keep an eye on things.
Will, have you got the ring?
I have. You think I'd trust him to remember?
It's a very great pleasure to us to see you here tonight. It's an honour you do us, and I assure you, speaking for my wife and for myself, that the
generous.
The generous warmth of the sentiment so cordially expressed by Mr. Beanstalk and seconded by expressed by Mr. Prosser and seconded by Mr. Beanstalk will never be forgotten by either my life partner or self. And I would like to drink this toast to you in my own house, our guests, and may they all be merry soon themselves.
Our guests.
In rising to respond,
sit down.
I'd like to thank
Willie. That's enough speeches. I know men fancy themselves when they're talking, but you've had one turn and you need it starts again.
But we ought to thank him, Alice.
I dare say, but you do not speak as well as he did, so we can leave it with a good wine talk. Have your tone, you took me by surprise, Will.
Oh yes, it was a very neat speech indeed.
Who taught you, Will?
I've been learning a lot lately.
I thought that speech never came natural from Will.
I'm educating him.
Oh well, he's a very apt pupil, I must say.
He'll do. Another 20 years and I know which one of you three men will be thought of most about the bank.
That's looking ahead a bit.
I'll admit, it needs a bit of imagination to see it now.
Well, the start's all right, you know. Snug little room, shop, bio, and so on. I was wondering where you raised the capital for this, Maggie.
I mustn't call it my shop, it's his.
Do you mean to tell me that Willie found the capital?
He's a saving sort.
He must be if you don't miss out on what Father used to pay.
But we have it, not all together. We've had help.
It's a mystery to me where you got it from.
Same place as those flowers, Albert.
Hot house flowers, I see. I was wondering where they came from.
Same place as the money, Albert.
Well, I think we ought to get home, Maggie.
Shouldn't marvel. I reckon Toby's a bit tired looking after the shop by now. And your father's waking him come in.
That's it, I'm a bit nervous.
We'll have an edge on us, Tempo. Better get your hats on. Will, can you leave the table when they're gone?
You
better stop playing the
pots away. Yes, Maggie. But he's the husband. Why would he do that?
And you and Freddie, just lend them a hand with the washing up, Albert.
Me wash pots?
Maggie would guess.
I know. Only Albert laughed at Willie. And washing up will make him think on. It's not allowed.
Are you going to wash the pots?
Are you?
I look at it like this myself. All being well, you and I are married into this family. We both know what Maggie is. We start giving in to her now, she's going to be a nuisance to us all our lives.
That's right enough. But there's this plan of hers to get us married. And are you prepared to work it for us?
I'm not. Anything
well, but. Well then, until it's done, we have to keep the sweet side of Maggie.
Washing pots?
What would you do in our place, Will?
Please yourselves, getting on with what you told me.
Yeah, well, you're married to her, we are.
What do you need the table for in such a hurry?
Hey, I'm not in a hurry myself.
Yeah, well, Maggie wants it for something.
It'll be for my lessons, I reckon. She's schooling me.
Yeah, don't you want to learn?
Isn't that? I just thought I'd to be rude turning me out so early. I don't see me to go away so soon.
Why not?
I'm fond of a bit of company.
Do you want company in your wedding night?
I don't think he's going so soon.
He's afraid to be alone with her, that's what it is. He's shy of his wife,
huh? That's a fact. I've not been married before, you see. And I've not been left alone with her either. Until now, she's been coming down to where I lodged at Tubby Wanlow's to give me my lessons. It's different now.
And I freely own I'm feeling awkward, like I'd be deeply obliged if you stay on a bit to help to thaw the ice.
You've been engaged to her.
Oh my. Aye. But it went for long, and you see, Maggie's not the sort you get familiar with.
Well, you've had quite long enough to thaw the ice. And it's not our job to do your melting for you.
No. Fred, these pots need washing. We'll wash them.
Fred, would you like it yourself with a wench like Maggie?
But that's not the point. It's not me she married.
It's a being a war with her that worries me. And I'd like to think you'd stand by a fellow man and make things not so strange at first.
Not the way we look at it. Hurry up, folks. Good, Fred.
Broken anything yet, Albert?
Broken, no.
Too slow, do I expect?
I must say you don't show much gratitude.
Aren't you at all surprised to find us doing this?
Surprised? I told you to do it.
Yes,
but... You can stop now. I'll finish when you've gone.
Who's that?
You can't read, I reckon. You hung that card on the door, Will.
Aye. It's there and you wrote it, Maggie.
I knew better than to trust to you. Business suspended for the day, it says. And if I can't read it, can go on knocking.
Are you
in,
Maggie?
It's Father!
Oh,
Lord! Are you afraid of him?
Well, I think all things considered, seeing as we're in.
We'll consider them. You can go to the bedroom, the lot of you. No, not you, Willie, the rest. I'll shut when I want to.
Well, he's gone.
It'll be before he's gone.
But we don't have Father.
It's just your house or mine.
It's your cellar.
And I'm in charge of it. You sit still, and don't forget your gaffer. I'll open the door.
Well, Maggie.
Well, Father.
I'll come in.
Well, I don't know. I'll have to ask the master about that.
The master?
You and him didn't part on the best of terms, you know. Will, it's my father. Is he to come in?
Aye. Let him come.
You didn't sound cordial about your invitation, young man.
Nay, but I am. I'm right down glad to see you, Mr. Hobson. It makes Wednesday complete, like you being a father and all, and I hope you see your way to stay a good long while.
Well,
you can sit down for 5 minutes, Father. That's all I'll bear your weight. It's been tested.
There's double tea to drink, and I reckon what's in the pot is stew, so...
You'll do not, sir. Father likes his liquid strong.
Piece of pork pie now, Mr. Hobson.
Pork pie.
You'll be sociable now you're here, I hope.
It wasn't sociability that brought me here, Maggie.
What was it, then?
Maggie, I'm in disgrace. A sore and sad misfortune has fallen on me.
Have a piece of wedding cake will do you good.
Oh, sweet.
That's natural in cake.
I've gotten such a head.
Aye, but wedding cake's a question apart. There'd be no bride's cakes made at all if we thought about our heads first.
Maggie,
I understand it's foolishness, but if I wish to see my father eating my wedding cake on my wedding day.
This is serious, Maggie, what I've gone for.
Not more serious than knowing that you wish us well.
Well, Maggie, you know my ways. When a thing's done, it's done. You had your way and done what you wanted, and I'm proud of the choice you've made, and I'll not lie and say I am, but the milk's spilt and I'll not cry.
Then there's your cake, and you can eat it.
I give you my word, there's no ill feeling.
So now, we'll have the deed.
You're a hard woman. No consideration for the weakness of old age.
Finish.
Thanks for that tea.
Now, tell me what it is you came about.
I'm in sore trouble, Maggie.
Then I'll leave you with my husband to talk it over.
Eh?
You'll not be wanting me. Women are only in your way.
Maggie! you're not going to desert me in my hour of need, are you?
Surely to goodness you don't want a woman about after all you've said. Will do his best, I make no doubt. Call me when you finish, Will.
Maggie, it's private.
Why, yes, I'm going, and you can talk about it man to man with no fools or women about.
No, it's you I came to see, not him. It's private from him.
Private from Will? No, it isn't. You've not to say to me that can't be said to him.
I have to tell you this with him there.
Will and me is one.
Sit down, Mr. Hobson.
You call him father now.
Do I?
Does he?
He does. Sit down, Will. Now, Father, if you're ready, we are. What's the matter?
That's the matter.
What is it, Will?
Ruin! Ruin and bankruptcy, that's what it is, Maggie. Am I Vicar's Warden at St. Philip's, or am I not? Am I Hobson of Hobson's Bootshop, Salford? Am I a respectable ratepayer and the father of a family?
It's an action for damages for trespass, I say.
It's a stab in the back! It's an unfair, un-English, cowardly way of taking a mean advantage of a casual accident.
Did you trespass?
Maggie, I say it solemnly. It's all your fault. I had an accident, I don't deny it. I was at Moonraker's and I stayed too long. And why? Why did I stay too long? To try to forget that I'd a thankless child, to erase from the tablets of memory the recollection of your conduct. That was the cause of it. And the result, the blasting, withering result, I fell into that cellar, I slept in that cellar, and I awoke to this. Catastrophe! Lawyers! Law costs! Bankruptcy! Ruin!
I'm still asking you, was it an accident, or did you trespass?
It was an accident. It's as sure as Salford Town Hall it was an accident, but them that live by law have twisted ways of putting things that make white show as black. They've got me in their grip at last. I've hated lawyers all my life. I've avoided them, and now they have their chance to make me bleed for it. I've dodged them, and they've caught me in the end, and they're... Squeeze me dry for it!
My word. Now that's something like a squeezing home.
I can say it's serious. I shouldn't wonder if you didn't know some trade from this.
Wonder? It's as certain as Christmas. The best class customers aren't going to buy their boots from a man who's stood up in open court and had to admit that he was overcome at 12 in the morning. They'll not remember it was private grief that caused it. They'll only blame me because I couldn't control my daughter better than to let her go and become a misery to me in my old age. That's what you've done. Brought this on me. You two, between you.
Do you think it will get in the paper, Maggie?
Yes, for sure. You'll see your name in the Salford Reporter, Father.
Salford Reporter, aye, and more. When there's ruin and despair and outrageous fortune overcomes a man of my importance in the world, it isn't only the Salford Reporter that takes note of it. This awful cross that's come to me will be recorded in the Manchester Guardian for the whole of Lancashire to read.
Hey, by gum, figure that. To have your name appearing in a Guardian? Why, it's very near worthwhile to be ruined for the pleasure of that reading about yourself in a printed paper.
It's there for others to read besides me, my lad.
Aye, you're right. I didn't think of that. This will give a lot of satisfaction to a many I can name. Other people's troubles is mostly what folks read the paper for, and I reckon it's twice the pleasure to them when it's the trouble of a man they know themselves.
Well, to hear you talk, it sounds like a pleasure to you.
Aye. It's not. You made my wedding cake, and you shook my hand. We're friends, I hope. And I will never meditate, my friend. I always think it's best to look on the worst side of things first, then, while the chances can't be worse than you look for. It's St. Philip's now. I don't suppose you'll go on being Vicar's Warden after this to do. And it brought you a powerful lot of customers, did that?
Get a lot of comfort from your husband, Maggie.
That's about what you deserve.
Any more words of consolation for me, Will?
I only spoke what came into my mind.
Well, have you spoken at all?
I can keep my mouth shut, if you'd rather.
Don't you strain yourself, Will Mutter.
When a man's got ideas like yours, they're better out than in. You let them come, my lad, they'll leave a cleaner place behind.
Not much good at talking. I always seem to say the wrong things when I do talk. I'm sorry if my well-meant words don't suit your taste, but I thought you came here for advice.
I didn't come to see you! You jumped
I don't
up!
Do
cut out open!
My husband's trying to help you.
Yes, Maggie.
Now, about this accident of yours.
Yes, Maggie.
It's the publicity you're afraid of most.
It's being dragged into a court of law at all. Me, who's been voted right all my life and been a sound supporter of the Queen and Constitution.
Then we must try to keep it out of court.
If there are lawyers in heaven, Maggie, they may keep cases out of court there. But on earth, a lawyer's job is to squeeze a man and squeeze him where he's squirming seen the most, in court.
I've heard of cases being settled out of court. In private.
In private? Aye, and all the worse for that. It's done between themselves, behind closed doors, in lawyers' offices where no one can see. They're squeezing twice as hard in private than they dare to do in public. There's some restraint in a public place, but privately? Cost me a fortune to settle this in private.
I don't doubt it's going to cost you something. But you'd rather do it privately than publicly.
If only it were not a lawyer's office.
You can settle it with a lawyer out of his office. You can settle it with him here. Albert! This is Mr. Prosser, a Prosser Pilkington and Prosser.
He is?
Yes.
You're a lawyer?
Yes, so I'm a lawyer.
And you're a...
Come out, all of you.
Alice, Mickey.
Family gathering. This is Mr. Beanstalk, a beanstalking company.
How you do?
What, here?
When you've got a thing to settle, you need all the parties to be present.
But what are they doing here, Alice and Mickey? What? Who's taking care of the shop?
Tommy Wander's looking after it.
It's his job to look after the shop?
He's got another job. The shop's a slack since Maggie left.
Oh, and do you run the shop? Do you give orders then? Do you decide when to put your hats on and walk out of it?
They come out because it's my wedding day, Father. That's reason enough. And Will and me will do the same for them. We'll close shop and welcome on their wedding days.
Their wedding days? That's a long ways off. Be many a year before there's another wedding in this family, I give you my word. One daughter defying me is bad enough.
How don't we better get to business, sir?
Young man, don't abuse a noble word. You're a lawyer. By your own admission, you're a lawyer. Honest men live by business. Lawyers live by law.
In this matter, sir, I'm following the instructions of my client, Mr. Beanstalk. And the remark you have just let fall before witnesses appears to me to bear libelous reflection on the action of my client.
What? So it's libel now? Isn't trespass and spying on trade secrets enough for you? You blood-sucking!
One moment, Mr. Hobson. You can call me what you like.
And I shall!
But I wish to remind you in your own interest that abuse of a law is remembered in the courts. Now, a client tells me he's prepared to settle this matter out of court. Personally, I don't advise him to, because we should probably get higher damages in court. Mr. Beanstalk has no desire to be vindictive. He remembers your position, your reputation for respectability, and he also remembers... I beg your pardon?
I'm not so fond of the sound of your voice as you are. What's the price?
The sum we propose, which will include my ordinary costs, but not any additional costs incurred by your use of defamatory language towards me, is £1,000.
What?
It isn't.
£1,000 for tumbling down a cellar? I might have broken my leg.
That is in the nature of an omission, Mr. Hobson. A flower vase to save your leg from fracture, and I am therefore inclined to add to the sum I have stated. A reasonable estimate of the doctor's bill we have saved you by protecting your legs with our flower bags.
Ah, Albert Prosser, I can see that you're going to get on in the world, but you need to be greedy here. That 1,000's too much.
We
thought maybe... You can think again. If there are any more signs of greediness from either of you, there'll be a counteraction for personal damages due to your criminal carelessness in leaving your cellar flap open.
Maggie, you saved me. I'll take that action. I'll show them up.
You're not damaged. And one lawyer's quiet enough. But he'll be more reasonable now, I hope. And I'm perfectly about what Father can afford to pay, and it's not £1,000 or anything like £1,000.
Not so much I'm able to afford, Maggie. You'll make me out a pauper.
You can afford £500 And you're going to pay £500.
Oh, but there's a difference between affording and paying.
You can go to the courts and be reported in the papers if you like.
What's the principle of the thing? I'm being beaten by a lawyer.
Father, dear, how can you be beaten when they wanted £1,000 and you're only going to pay £500?
Well, I hadn't thought of that.
They were beaten.
I take quite a few beatings myself at the price, Vicky. But,
I want this keep another court.
Then we can take it settled.
You want to see the money before you believe me? Is that your nasty lawyer's way?
Oh, no, not at all, Miss Hobson. Your word is as good as your bond.
It's settled!
I don't see what you have to squeal about, Vicky. I mean, I'm not being dragged to public scorn, but, you know, it's a tidy sum of money to be leaving the family.
It's not leaving the family, Father.
We'll see how you make it out.
Their wedding days are not so far off as you thought. Now there's a half of 500 apiece for them to make a start on.
You mean to tell
me... You won't
me...
forget that you've passed your word, will you, Father?
I've been diddled.
This is a plant!
It takes two daughters off your hands at once and clears your shop of all the fools and women that used to lumber up the place.
It will be much easier for you without us in your way, Father.
Aye. Then you can keep out of my way at all! You hear that? All of you!
Father!
I'll run that shop with men and I'll show Selfred how it should be run. Don't you imagine there'll be room for you when you come home crying and tired of your fine husbands? I'm rid of you! And it's a lasting riddance, mind. I'll pay this money that you robbed me of, and that's an end of it. All of you. You especially, Maggie. I'm not blind yet, and I can see who's got to blame for this.
Don't be vicious, Father.
Well, Mossop, I'm sorry for you, lad. Take you for all in all, you're the best of the bunch. You're a backward lad, but you know you're trained, and it's an honest one.
So does my Albert know his trade.
Oh, I got to that. He knows his trade. He's good at robbery. And I have to have it on me conscience that my daughters have married a lawyer and an employer of lawyers.
It didn't worry your conscience to keep us serving in the shop at no wages.
I kept you, didn't I? It's someone else's job to bill you in future. Ah, you may grin, you two, but... Girls don't live on air. Your penny buns will cost you tuppence now and more. Wait till the family's beginning to come. Don't come to me for keep, that's all.
Oh, Father!
Aye. You may father me, but that's a piece of work I'm finished with. I'm done with fathering, and they're beginning it. They'll learn soon what it's like to marry a woman. I've thrown the shackles off and they're putting chains on them. I've suffered 30 years and more and I'm a free man from the day. Lord, what a thing you're taking on, you poor, poor wretches. You red-nosed rubbers, but you're gonna pay for it!
You had better arrange to get married quick. I'll send Vicky out a sweet time with him.
Can they go home at all?
Why not?
Well, after what he said.
He won't remember half of it. He's for the Moonrakers now, this time. What is his hand?
Simon, we're going, Maggie. You'll be glad to see the back of us.
No. No, I wouldn't dream of asking you to go.
Then I would. It's high time we turned you out. Here are your hats. Good night.
Good night.
Good night, Maggie. And thank you. All right. Well, don't come around here too often, because me and Will are going to be busy. I dare say you find enough to do with yourself getting wet.
I dare say.
Send us word when the day is.
We'll be glad to see you at the wedding, Maggie.
We'll come to that. Give you a grand for us afterwards.
Oh, no, Maggie.
Well, Heaven will be catching up with you before long. We're only starting here. Good night.
Good night, Maggie.
Now you've heard what I've said of you. In 20 years you're going to be more put off than either of your brothers-in-law.
I heard you say it, Maggie.
I want to make it good. I'm not a boaster, Will, and it's going to be less than 20 and all.
Well, I don't know. Maybe a long start on us.
And you've got me. Go and get your slate, it's in the bedroom. I'll have the table clear by the time you come back. Thank you.
slate?
Let me see it first. This is what you did at Toppy Woodlaw's after I came here last night.
Yes, Maggie.
There's always room at the top. Your writing's improving, Will. I'll set you a short copy for tonight, because it's getting late and we've a lot to do in the morning. Great things grow from small. Now sit here and copy that. Flowers of Mrs. Hepworth behind the fire, Will. Well, not what litter can walk in time tomorrow.
You're saving one.
I thought of Prissa and the Bible as a keepsake, Will. I'm not beyond liking to be reminded of today. Lord, I'm tired. I reckon I'll leave those pots till morning. Slackish way of starting, but I don't get married every day.
No.
I'm for my bed. You come when you finish that copy.
him, fry him up, fry him up, fry him up. Cop me piggy and fry him up. Now this baby.
I'll go sit up, W.
He's getting up, Mr. Reader.
Getting up? What, you said he was going
to... I told you what he told me to tell you. Run for Dr. McFarlane, he said. Not run for Dr. McFarlane. Now go to Mr. Reeler, he said, and tell him I'm very ill. And I came and told you. Then he said he would get up and I was to have breakfast ready for him and he'd see you down.
No, he says, Dobby. Of course I'll go to him.
You know what he is, sir. I'll get blamed if you go. Any short temper this morning?
I don't want you to get into trouble, Toby.
Thank you, Mr. Reeler.
I thought it was something serious.
Oh, if you ask me, it is.
Oh, which way?
Every way you look at it. Mr. Hobson's not his own old self. The shop's not its own old self. And look at me. I ask you, Mr. Healer, man to man. Does this work for a foreman shoe and cooking and laying tables?
By all accounts, there's not much else for you to do.
Well, there's better things than being a housemaid if it's only making clogs.
Oh, they tell me clogged or cut mine.
Well, what are you to do? There's nothing else wanted. Hobson's in a bad way, and I'm telling no secret when I say it. It's a fact that's known.
Oh, it's a thousand pities with an old established trade like this.
And who's to blame?
I don't think you ought to discuss this with me, Tubby.
Don't you? I'm an old servant of the master's, and I'm sticking to him now when everybody's calling me a doting fool because I don't look after Tubby Wadlow first. If that don't give me the right to say what I please, I don't know. His temper's ruining his shop, Mr. Healer. Temper and obstinacy!
They say in Chapel Street it's Will Mosser.
Well, he's a good lad, though I say it that trained him. He hit us hard there, Willie, but we'd have got round that in time. With care, you understand? And tact. Tact. That's what the gaffer lacks. Miss Maggie now.
Well, she's a marvel. Aye. Fair knockout.
Not slavish, mind you. Stood up to the customers all the time, but she'd away with it. It sold the goods and made them come again for more. Look at us now, oi! Men, assistants in the shop, oi! Breakfast!
Was more than we
cost. They'd be dear at any price. Look here, Mr. Healer, take yourself. When you go to buy a pair of boots, you like to be tried on by a man or by a nice, soft, young woman. There you are. Stands to reason. Human nature.
But there are two swords there, Tubby. Look at the other.
Ladies.
Aye.
Ladies that are ladies once trying on by their own sex. And them that aren't buys clogs. It's the good class trade that pays. And Hobson's have lost it.
Jim. Well, Henry.
Oh, Jim.
Oi. Now, you sit in the armchair by the fire or at the table.
Table? Breakfast? Bacon? Bacon? And I'm like this.
What a man's like this. He wants a woman about the house, Henry.
I want, then.
Shall I go for Miss Maggie, sir? Mrs. Mossop, I mean.
Well, I think you don't. You should be here, Henry.
They should, only they're not. They're married, and I've been deserted by them all, and I'll die deserted. I mean, then I'll feel sorry for the way they treated me. Tubby, have you got no work to do in the shop?
I might find some if I looked hard.
Well, go and find it. And take that bacon with you. I don't like the smell.
You sure shouldn't go for Miss Maggie, sir.
Go for her. Go for the devil. Look, there is a big who you go for. I'm a dying man.
What's all this talk about dying, Henry?
Oh, Jim. I've sent for the doctor, Jim. We'll soon know how near the end is.
Well, this is very sordid. You've never been ill in your life.
It's all been saved up and come now all at once.
What are your symptoms, Henry?
I'm all one symptom, head to foot. I'm frightened of myself, Jim. That's worst. You'd say I was a clean man, Jim.
Clean, yes, I would. Cleaner body and mind.
I'm dirty now. I haven't washed this morning. I couldn't face the water. Only use I could find for the water was to drown myself. Same with the shaving. I've thrown the razor through the window. I had to, or it would slit my throat.
Come, Henry,
oh, God, come. It's awful. I'll never trust myself again. I'll grow a full beard if I live.
Oh, you cheat the undertaker, Henry. Well, I fancy a doctor could improve you. What is the cause of it now?
Moonrakers.
Oh, you don't think.
I don't think, I know. I've seen it come to others, I never thought it would come to me.
Well, no, me neither. You know it, October, Henry. I grant you regular, but you don't exceed. It's a hard thing if a man can't take a drop of air without it getting back at him like this. It might be my turn next.
Oi, here's Dr. McFarlane. Good morning, gentlemen. Where is my patient?
Here.
Here? Up?
Looks like it.
And for a patient who's downstairs, I'm made to rise from my bed at this hour.
What's that so early as all that?
But I've been up all night, sir. A young woman with her first. Have you, Mr. Hobbs?
Certainly not. I'm not ill.
Aye, there's no much to choose between you. You've both got your fate written on your faces.
You mean that I?
I mean he has and you will.
Doctor, will you attend to me?
Aye. Now, sir.
I've never been in a bad way before this morning. I've never wanted a doctor in my life.
You have needed, but you have no sense.
But this morning...
I ken well.
What, you know?
Any fool would ken.
Eh?
Any fool but one fool, and that's yourself.
Damn polite!
If you want flattery, I dare say you can get it from your friend. I'm giving you my medical opinion.
I want your opinion on my complaint, not on my character.
Your complaint and your character are the same.
Then you'll kindly separate them and you'll tell me.
I'll tell you nothing, sir. I don't diagnose as my patient's wish, but as my intellect and sagacity direct. Good morning to you.
Yeah, but you're not diagnosed.
Sir, if I'm to interview a patient in the presence of a third party, the least that third party can do is keep his mouth shut.
After that, there's only one thing, boy. Either he shifts or I do.
You'd better go, Jim.
Oh, but there are other doctors, Henry.
I'll keep this one. Teach him a lesson. Scotchmen can't come over Salford, lads, this road.
Ah, well, that's it, then I'll leave you.
Ah, that's it. I can bully just as well as a foreigner.
That's better, Mr. Hobbs.
Mine better. You've had little to do with it.
I think my calculated rudeness.
Oh, if you calculate your fees as high as your rudeness, they'll be high.
I calculate my time, Mr. Hobson. So we'd better get to business. Will you unbutton your shirt?
No hanky panky now.
Aye. Just confirms my first opinion. You've had a breakdown this AM.
I'd say so.
Melancholic? Depressed?
Question was whether the razor would get me or I'd get razor. I won that time. Razor's in the yard, but I'll never dare to try shaving myself again.
And do you seriously require me to tell you the cause, Mr. Hobson?
I'm paying the brass to tell me.
Chronic alcoholism, if you know what that means.
Aye?
A serious case.
I know it's serious. That's what you're here for. You're here to cure me.
Very well. I will write you a prescription.
Stop, Dad.
I beg your pardon.
I won't take it. None of your druggists muck for me. I'm particular about what I put in my stomach.
Mr. Hobbs! If you don't mend your manners, I'll certify you for a lunatic asylum. Are you aware you've drunk yourself within 6 months of the grave? You'd a warning this morning that any sane man would listen to. And you are going to listen to it, sir.
By taking your prescription?
Precisely. You will take this mixture, Mr. Hobson, and you will practice total abstinence for the future.
Denying me my legitimate... my legitimate drink?
I forbid alcohol. Absolutely.
What's good you're forbidden it is. I've had alcohol every day of my life as long as I can remember. If I'm going to die by beer, I'll die fighting. And I'm non-practicing unnatural teetotalism for the sake of lengthening out my unalcoholic days. Life's got to be worth living if I'm going to live it.
That's the way you talk, Mr. Hobson. My services are of no use to you.
They're not. I'll pay you on the nail for this.
I congratulate you on your impulse, Mr. Hobson.
Hey, I've had value, Doctor. You've been a tonic to me. When I woke up this morning, I thought I'd never see the inside of Moonrakers again, but I'm ready for my early morning draught this instant.
Man, will you no be warned? You're a pig-headed animal. Alcohol is poison to you. Deadly. Virulent with the system in the state uses.
You're getting warm about it. Will you take your fee?
Aye. When I've earned it, put it in your pocket, Mr. Hobson. Have they finished with you yet?
Thought you had.
You care that you're defying. You'll die fighting later. Aye, that's a gay high-sounding sentiment, my manny. But you'll no do it, do you hear? You'll no slip from me now. I've got my grip on you. You'll die sober. You'll live the longest time you can before you die. Have you a wife, Mr. Robson? In bed?
Higher than that.
Aye, that's a pity. A man like yourself should keep a wife handy.
I'm not so partial to women.
Women are a necessity, sir. Have you no a female relative that can manage you?
Manage?
Keep her thumb firm on you.
I have three daughters, Dr. McFarlane, who tried to keep their thumbs on me.
Well, where are they?
Married. Queerly married.
You drove them to it.
They all grew uppish. Maggie, worst of all.
Maggie. Then I'll tell you what you'll do, Mr. Hobson. You will get Maggie back. At any price, at all cost you of pride. As your medical man, I order you to get Maggie back. Now, I don't know Maggie, but I'll prescribe her. And damn you, sir, are you going to defy me again?
I tell you, I won't have it.
You'll have to have it. You're a dunder-headed lump of obstinacy. But I'm taking a fancy to you, and I decline to let you kill yourself.
I've escaped from the thraldom of women once.
And a pretty mess you've made of your liberty. Now this Maggie that you mentioned, if you just show me where she's to be found, I'll step round and have a crack with her myself, for I've gone beyond the sparing of a bit of trouble over you.
You waste your time.
I'll cure you, Mr. Hobson.
She won't come back.
Oh, well, that's a possibility. If she's a sensible body, I concur with your opinion, she'll no come back, but women are a soft-hearted race. And well, maybe she'll take pity on you after all.
No pity.
If she's a woman I take her for, you'll no get pity, you'll get discipline. Don't interrupt me, I'm talking.
I've noticed.
You asked me for a cure, and Maggie is the name of the cure that you need. Maggie, sir, do you hear? Maggie.
What about me?
Are you Maggie?
I'm Maggie.
You'll do.
What are you doing under my roof?
I've come because I was fetched.
Who fetched you?
Tubby Woodlow.
Tubby can quit this shop this minute!
Sit down, Mr. Hobson.
He said you're dangerously ill.
He is. I'm Dr. McFarlane. Will you come and live here again?
I'm married.
I know that, Mrs.
Mossop.
Your father is drinking himself to death.
Look here, Doctor. What's passed between you and me isn't for everybody's ears.
I judge your daughter's not the sort to want the truth wrapped around with a feather bed for fear it hits her hard.
Go on. I'd like to hear it all.
Just nasty-minded curiosity.
I don't agree, Mr. Hobson. Mrs. Mossop is to sacrifice her own home to come to you. She's every right to know the reason why.
Sacrifice? If you saw her home, you'd have another word than that. Two cellars in Old Fail Road.
I'm waiting, Doctor.
I have a constitutional objection to seeing patients slip through my fingers when it's avoidable, Mrs. Mossop. And I'll do my best for your father. But my medicine will no do him any good without your medicine to back me up. He needs a firm hand on him all the time.
I've not had the same chance I had before I married.
You'll no chance at all unless you come and live here again. Now, I will only tell you the duty of a daughter, because I doubt he's acted badly by you, but on the broad grounds of humanity, well, it's saving life if you'll come.
I might.
Name it, will you?
You've told me what you think. The rest is my business.
That's right, Maggie. That's what you get for interfering in people's private affairs. So now you can go with your tail between your legs, Dr. McFarlane.
On the contrary, I am going, Mr. Hobson, and with the profound conviction that I leave you in excellent hands. One prescription's on the table, Mrs. Mossop. The other two are total abstinence and yourself.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Tubby! Go around to Old Field Road and ask my husband to come here. And get this made up at Hollows on your way back.
Yes, please. Mrs. Mossop!
Tell Mr. Mossop I want him quick.
Maggie, you know I can't be an abstainer.
A man of my habits and my time of life?
You can't if I come here to make you.
Are you coming?
I don't know yet. I haven't asked my husband.
You ask little Mossop? Maggie had better thoughts of you than that. Making an excuse like that to me. If you want to come, you'll come. So what will Mossop says, and you know it.
I don't want to come, Father. I expect no holiday existence here to keep you in health. But if Will says it's my duty, then I shall come.
Who knows what is I do asking Will is a matter of form?
Matter of form? My husband a matter of form? He is the man in my life.
I know, but he's not the man who wears the breeches at your house.
My husband's my husband, Father, so whatever else he is. And my home is my home and all. And what you said of it just now to Dr. McFarlane's a thing you'll pay for. It's no gift to a married woman to come to the home she should have.
Look here, Maggie. You're talking straight, and I'll talk straight along. When I'm set, I'm set. You're coming here. I didn't want you when that doctor said it, but by gum, I want you now. It's been my daughter's hobby crossing me, and now you'll come look after me.
All of us.
No, not all of you. Your eldest.
There's another man with claims on me.
I'll give him claims. Aren't I your father?
And I'm not your only daughter.
You've been here long, Maggie.
A while.
Oh, well, a fashionable solicitor's wife doesn't rise to release the wife of a working cobbler. You'd be up when Tubby came.
A couple hours earlier.
You're looking all right, Father. You've got quite a colour.
I'm very ill.
He's not so well, Alice. The doctor says one of us must come and live here to look after him.
I live in the Crescent myself.
I've heard it was that way on. One of our homes will have to go.
I don't think I can be expected to come back to this after what I've been used to lately.
Alice!
Well, I say not to be Maggie, Father.
I'm saying you're...
Father, you're ill!
Vicky, oh, my baby! At last, I find a daughter who cares for me.
Of course I care, don't the others?
You will come and live with me, won't you, Vicky?
What?
One of us is needed to look after him.
Oh, but it can't be me in my circumstances, Maggie.
What circumstances?
Don't you know?
No.
What's the matter? What's all the whispering about?
Father, don't you think you ought to put a jacket on before Will comes?
Put a jacket on for Will Mossop? There's something wrong with your sense of proportion, my dear.
You're always pretending to folk about your husband, Maggie, but you need to keep it up with us. We know Will here.
Father, either I can go home or you can put a jacket on for Will. I'll have him treated with respect.
I expect you to put a jacket on in any case, Father.
Of course I'd put a jacket on, but mine isn't for the likes of Will Mossop. Because my back is cold.
Now then, which one of us is it to be?
It's no use looking at me like that, Maggie. I've told you I'm expecting.
I don't see that rules you out. It could happen to any of us.
Maggie.
What's the matter? Children do happen to married women, and we are all married.
Well, I'm not going to break my home up, and that's flat. My child comes first with me.
I say? You've a house of furniture, and you've a child coming, so Father can drink himself to death for you.
That's not for speaking. I'd come if there were no one else. You know very well it's your duty, Maggie.
Duty? I should think it'd be a pleasure to live here after you have two cellars.
I've had 30 years of the pleasure of living with Father. Thanks.
Do you mean to say you won't come?
It's not for me to say at all. It's for my husband.
Oh, do stop talking about your husband! If Alice and I don't need to ask our husbands, you never need to ask yours. Will Mossop has the spirit of a lass, and we know it as well as you do.
Maybe Will's come on since you last saw him, Vicky. It's getting on a while now. There he is in the shop. I'll go and put it to him.
Morning, lads.
Stop her!
Let her do it in her own way. I'm not coming back here.
Nor me.
There's only Maggie for it.
Yes, but we've got to be careful, Alice. She mustn't have things too much her way.
It's our way as well, isn't it?
Not coming as our way, but when... She's not here, and we're not here, and she's with Will. Can't you see what I'm thinking, Alice? It's so difficult to say. Suppose poor Father gets worse, and then I hear Maggie and Will, and you and I are out of sight and out of mind. Can't you see what I mean?
He might leave him his money.
That would be most unfair to us.
Father must make his will at once. Albert, shall you also?
That's it, Alice. And don't let's leave Maggie too long with Will. She's only telling him what to say, and then she'll pretend he thought of it himself. Why
something to come into a thing. I like to know what I'm coming into.
That's never William Mossop.
Are you coming into this?
That's a proposal, isn't it?
I didn't know it was.
Now then, Maggie, go and bring your father down and be sharp. I'm very busy at my shop, so what they are it is. It's been a good business in this day too, has Hobson's.
What on earth do you mean it's a good business still?
You try and sell it and you know stock and goodwill would fetch about 200.
Don't talk so foolish, Will. 200 for a business like father's.
200 as it is, not as it was in our time, Vicky.
Do you mean to tell me father isn't rich?
If you're not married into the law, you know what they think of your father today in trading circles. Vicky ought to know her husband's in trade.
Oh, my friend in trade?
Isn't he?
He's in the wholesale, that's business, not trade. And the value of father's shop is no affair of yours, Will Mossop.
Now, I thought maybe it was, if Maggie and me are coming here.
You're coming to look after father!
Maggie can do that with one hand tied behind her back. How? I'll look after the business.
You'll do what's arranged for you.
I'll do the arranging, Alice. Mm-hmm. We come here on my terms.
They'll be fair terms.
I'll see they're fair to me and Maggie.
Well, Mossop, do you know who you're talking to?
Aye, my wife's young sisters. Times have changed a bit since you used to order me about the shop, haven't they, Alice?
Yes, I'm Mrs. Albert Prosser now.
Tell you are, to outsiders. And you'd be surprised the number of people who call me Mr. Mossop now. We do get on in the world, don't we?
Some folks get on too fast.
It's a matter of opinion. I know Maggie and me both gave you a big leg up when we arranged your marriage portions, but I don't know grudging you the sudden lift you got. Good morning, Father. I'm sorry to hear you're not so well.
A changed man, Will.
There used to be room for improvement. What?
Sit down, Father.
I don't let us be too long about this. I'm very busy at my shop, and you've kept me waiting a good while now. My time's valuable.
Is your shop more important than my life?
That's a bit like asking if a pound of tea weighs heavier than a pound of lead. I'm worried about your life because it worries Maggie. But I'm not worried that bad. I'll see my business suffer for the sake of you.
This is not what I have a right to expect of you, Will Mother.
You've no right to expect I care whether you sink or swim!
Will!
What's to do? You told me you'd take a high hand, didn't you?
I'm going to stay here and watch Maggie and Will abuse her father when he's ill!
No need for you to stay.
And that's a true word, Will Mossop.
Father, you take his side against your own flesh and blood!
That doesn't come so well from you, my dear. You neither of you would leave your homes to come care for me, so you're not for me, you're against me.
We're not against her, Father. We want to stay and see that Will deals fairly by you.
Oh, I'm not capable of taking care of myself, am I? I'm to be protected by you girls, lest I be overreached. And overreached by whom? Will Mossop? I may be ailing, but quite enough left in me for a dozen such as him. And if you think the manhood's left me, you can go and think it's somewhere else than in my house.
But Father, dear Father.
I'm not so dear to you as you'd think twice about coming here to do for me, let alone jibing at it the way you did. A proper daughter would have jumped, aye, skipped like a calf by the cedars of Lebanon at the thought of being helpful to her father.
Did Maggie skip?
She's a bit ancient for the skipping exercise. She's coming round to the consideration of living here, which is more than you're willing to do, eh, Alice? Are you willing to come?
No.
Are you, Vicky?
It's my child, Father.
Never mind what it is. Are you coming or not?
No.
Then you, who are not willing, can leave me to talk with them that are.
Do you mean we're to go?
I understand you have homes to go to.
Oh, Father!
Open the door for them, Will.
Nicky!
Well, I don't know!
We'll be happy to see you here on Sunday for tea time, if you'll condescend to come sometime.
Beggars on horseback!
Nay, come! There's no will.
Now, my lad, I'll tell you what I'll do.
Aye, we could come to grips better now, there are no fine ladies about.
They're stiff-necked with pride, and the difference between you two is the difference I ought to mark, and I'm going to mark. Now, you're coming here to live, both of you, and you can have the back bedroom for your use, and the use of this room split along with me. Maggie will keep house, and if she's free time, she can help out in the shop. Finding Will a job. You can have your old bench back in the cellar, Will, and I'll pay you the old wage of 18 shillings a week, and you and me'll go equal wax in the keep of the house. Now, that's not handsome, I don't know what is. I'm finding you a house rent-free and paying half the key for your wife.
Come home, Maggie.
I think I'll have to.
What's all the rush for?
It may be news to you, but I've a business down in Oldfield Road and I'm neglecting it with wasting my time here.
Wasting time? Maggie, what's wrong with Willie?
He's a shop of his own to see to, Father.
Oh, man who's been offered a job at Hobson's doesn't need to worry about a shop of his own in a wretched cellar in Oldfield Road.
Shall I tell him, Maggie? Or shall we go?
Go! I don't want to talk to
him. If he goes, I go with him. You had better speak out, Will.
All right. Will, we've been a year in your wretched cellar, and you know what we've done? We paid off Mrs. Hepworth what she lent us for our start, and made a bit of brass on top of that. We've got your high-class trade away from you. That shop's a cellar, and as you say, it's wretched, but they come to us in it, and they don't come to you. Your trade's gone down till all you sell is clogs, and now you're on your bended knees to her and come and live with you, and all you think to offer me is my old job. At 18 shillings a week. Me, that's the owner of a business that's starving yours to death.
But you're Will Mossett, my old shoe hand.
Aye, I were. But I've moved on a bit since then. My daughter married me. Said about my education. And now, I'll tell you what I'll do. And it'll be the handsome thing and all from me to you. I'll close my shop.
Oh, that doesn't sound as if you're doing so well.
I'm doing well, but I'll do better here. I'll transfer to this address, and what I'll do that's generous is this. I'll take you into partnership and give you your half share on the condition you're sleeping partner and you don't try interference on with me.
Partnership? You here?
William Mossop, Leigh Hobson is the name the shop will have.
Wait a bit, Will. I don't agree to that.
Oh, so you spoke up at last. I was beginning to think you had lost your senses together.
It had better not be late, Hobson's, Will.
Well, I meant it should.
Well, let me see if I get this straight. I have to be given a half share of my own business on the condition I take no part in running it? Is that what you said?
That's it.
I've heard of impudence.
It's all right, Father.
But did you hear what he said?
Yes, that's settled. Quite settled. It's only the name we're arguing about. I won't have let Hobson's, Will.
Well, not dead yet, my lad, not sure you're not.
I think Hobson and Mossop is best.
His name on my signboard?
I think the best we'll do is this. Mossop and Hobson.
No.
Mossop and Hobson, or it's Oldfield Road for us, Maggie!
Very well. Mossop and Hobson.
But, well, I'll make some alterations in all in this shop, I will, so.
Alterations in my shop?
In mine!
Look at that chair! How can you expect a high-class customers to come and sit on a chair like that? Why, we'd only a cellar, but they did sit on cretonne for their drying on.
Cretonne? That's pampering folk.
Cretonne for a cellar, and Morocco for this shop. Folk like to be pampered. Peppering pays. There'll be a carpet on that floor too.
Carpet? Morocco? Young man, you think this is St. Anne's Square, Manchester?
Not yet.
Whatever it is.
But it's going to be. It's no farther from Chapel Street to St. Anne's Square than it is from Oldfield Road to Chapel Street. Or, no, I got that wrong, didn't I? It's no farther from Chapel Street to St. Anne's Square than it's from Oldfield Road to Chapel Street, or whatever. I've done one jump in a year. If I wait a bit, I'll do the other. Maggie? I reckon your father could do with a bit of fresh air after this. I dare say it's come sudden to him. Suppose you walk with him to Albert Cross's office and get Albert to draw up the deed of partnership.
Get my hat. He's crushed like Maggie. I'm afraid I bored him too hard.
You needn't be.
I said such things to him. Well, they sounded as if I meant them too.
Yeah. Didn't you?
Did I? Yes. I suppose I did. That's just the worst for me to him. You told me to use the power that's come to me through you, but he's the old master.
And you're the new.
Master of Hobson's. It's an outrageous big idea. Did I sound confident?
You did all right.
Aye, but I went by half so certain as I sounded. Words came from a mouth that made me jump at my own boldness, and when it came to facing you about the name, I tell you, I fair trembled in my shoes. I was carried away.
Don't spoil it, Will. You're the man that I've made you, and I'm proud.
My pride is not the same street, lass. But the pride I have in you. And that reminds me.
A job to see to.
What job?
Oh, about the improvements.
You'll not do out without consulting me.
I'll do this, lass.
What are you doing? You leave my wedding ring alone.
You've worn a brass one long enough.
I'll wear this ring forever, Will.
I was forgetting you a proper one.
And I'm not preventing you. I'll wear your gold for show, but that brass stays where you put it, Will. And if we get too rich and proud, we'll just sit together quiet for a long time together, so we'll not forget the truth about ourselves. Eh, lad?
Hey, lass.
Ready, Father?
Yes, Peggy.
Come along to Albert.
Well, by gum.